Yeah. Yeah.
It's all about the Benjamins, baby.
Yeah.
You can't touch this. You can't touch this. You can't touch this. Can't touch this. Can't touch this. Can't touch this. Can't touch this.
Up 7 easy. There's a reason why after 100 channels destroyed, Angel Snuff Nuff 7 is still here. There's a reason why nobody want to get in a beef with Angel Snuff Nuff 7. But you don't take me seriously, and now your ass is barbecue. care about the people. But Angel Snuff Nuff 7 cares about the people, because I'm bold enough to tell you the truth, and I don't give a damn if you give me a dime. I'm not looking for your money.
We are in a state of emergency.
Prejudice. Wrote a song about it? Like to hear it? Here it go.
Free your mind.
Yes.
Come on, assemble the people, come on. We will not be defeated by witch doctors' illusions.
Everybody who is black and interested in black people, let us sit down and find out how we can get together in one direction against one enemy and accomplish this job overnight.
When soul singer and black activist Sam Cooke wrote the lyrics to his song, A Change Is Gonna Come, it was very direct and to the point. With some changes to it, the song was still digestible. In the year 2019, black folks continue to go through the change rather than direct the change. A community activist named Talik Ibn Rod has made an appeal similar to what Sam Cooke was asking for. A change. It's said that the meek shall inherit the earth. We ask when. When will the landlords give the meek a free lease? Mr. Ebenrod is humbly asking for the state of Mississippi. This is Dusty Basement Studios, and we approve of this message.
The Mississippi campaign represents everything that you claim that you want. The beginning of an all-black independent nation. The ability to control.
nigga or anybody on the planet would want. You're fake, you don't want to do nothing. 3 hours talking about the Mississippi campaign.
Keeps it real like that.
You know, I was wondering, you know, if you could keep it.
Your channel, you haven't put nothing on your channel, I guess, lately.
Yeah, but I've been thinking about like talking about real life subjects on my channel.
Okay, all right,
yeah, like well, you know, like that. Just been thinking of some ideas.
Well, we can come up. I can come up with some junior reality stuff that we can talk about.
Okay.
Yeah. The 1970s, and they was talking about, these young boys was talking about, yeah man, I'm gonna take my bitch to the movies later on. We gonna go down to the Dairy Queen later on. Take my bitch. I didn't like, he was part of that conversation. Now I did not like that when he was making reference to this young lady as a hoe and a bitch, because I know that's not what she was about. But you know, you want to show off in front of your other friends and the other boys, and they're calling their girlfriends hoes and bitches. They did not talk about, this is my future wife, I love her, this is my hoe, this is my bitch. Now, I did not like that. Now, here are some young teenage boys, including myself. 1970, we calling our sisters hoes and bitches. I did not do that. I've never been that way, never. Where do you think they're getting this from? Some of them got this from watching those black exploitation movies. I never watched those movies. I just recently saw some of those type of films. They watch some of these black exploitation pimp movies. So that's where they got hoes and bitches from. But also grown ass men. Cause I know grown ass men came to me calling sisters hoes and bitches. And they wanted me to do that. And I would not get involved in that type of crap. I've always had respect because that's who raised me. My mother, I view women as very strong. I saw them as stronger than the men around me.
Thank you. video is for the Reality Temple on Earth.
Shout out to the Reality Temple on Earth on IG.
We love watching it.
Yeah, we really do.
We send love, peace, and soul. Good evening, soul brothers and sisters. This is Tangi Cox, the Black Sheep. And I am propositioning you to entertain just a little while of being in reality. And this is gonna hurt soul sisters and brothers because a lot of us cannot accept reality. I empower you to, for 1 year, to subscribe to the Reality Temple on Earth. And at the end of 12 months, draw your conclusion of what have you learned in that amount of time. I empower you. You will never, ever, ever think, feel, or entertain nonsense ever again, period. I would like to see my soul sisters and brothers awaken. This requires time. You need to spend about a year watching, researching, and looking. The Reality Temple on Earth is life-changing, and I stand on that.
Let's get this party started. Ride, ride, ride. Let's get this party started quickly. Let's get this party started quickly. Let's get this party started. Ride, ride, ride. Let's get this party started. Ride, ride, ride. Let's get this party started quickly. Let's get this party started quickly. Let's get this party started. Ride, ride, ride. Let's get this party started. Ride, ride, ride. Let's get this party started quickly. Let's get this party started quickly. Let's get this party started. Ride, ride, ride. Let's get this party started. Ride, ride, ride. Let's get this party started quickly. Let's get this party started quickly. Let's get this party started. Ride, ride, ride. Let's get this party started. Ride, ride, ride. Let's get this party started quickly.
Touch this. You can't touch this. You can't touch this. You can't touch this. You can't touch this.
Get out! YouTube. This is Tangelika the Black Sheep. I am welcoming you to join me on my new YouTube page where I'll be discussing motivational Angelica the Black Sheep.
You can't touch this. You can't touch this. You can't touch this. You can't touch this. You can't touch this.
So as y'all can see, my background is everything. So yeah, I have to step it up a little bit. Feel me? If I'm gonna do this shit, I'm gonna do this shit right. So I needed to make sure that the background is everything. You know, plus people look past the messenger. So when you look past me, you're going to see something wonderful. However, I hope everybody is having a wonderful night and evening. And this video that I'm doing is going to be my part two of the making of an alcoholic in celebration of my anniversary of my sobriety day. And I'm truly excited about this, and reflecting back on this is liberating and freeing. And so I'm gonna just dive right into it. And I know that I can come off as aggressive on these lives, but just know I get a kick out of mimicking pimping preachers. So when I say that, it's all right. Know that I think I'm funny. And my son doesn't, he doesn't laugh. And I'll be like, why isn't he laughing? This is so hilarious to me. And he don't think it's funny. So turn to your neighbors and say, neighbors, Josiah don't know what true humor is, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah, but yeah, so anyway, I'm in the building. Come on and tap in. Shout out to my homegirl Capone, Bad Habit Capone. I hope she tuned into this live. You know what I'm saying? Shout out to the Avalons. Shout out to all the Avalons. Shout out to my biggest bad habit, Mr. Bad Habit Mumbles, that rest in peace. You know, this time a year is gonna be very trying because it's just a lot, man. He passed away August 30th, and I'm not really looking forward to that as well, but I'm going to stick to the topic. The topic is the making of an alcoholic. So, in the last video, I talked about some things that was did and said to me as a child, and a lot of things I went through as a kid, and it's a lot more to it than that. A whole lot more. So, yeah. And this is all being done for my record. And this is going to help me to put everything in its proper organized place in the form of a book. I'm also going to have Kindle videos and audios, you know, because some people like story time with vision. So, you know, I'm gonna try to have that as well. If it's possible, I'm gonna make getting my story out as easy and as convenient as possible, because sometimes books can just be boring as hell. It doesn't matter who wrote the book. Just the fact of looking at a damn book sometimes makes me sleepy. But I make myself read. So yeah, let's get back into the making of an alcoholic. And I'm going to start putting viewer discretion is advised. This time I really made sure that my daughter is asleep. My son is, you know, he really don't pay my lives no attention. He tap into the kitchen and he tap back into his room. He's not really paying attention or listening. Hi, Miss Duffy Johnson, Miss Vivian Duffy Johnson. Hello, how are you? You are on time. I'm about to go in. I'm going to keep talking about the making of an alcoholic. This video is to make it to my YouTube channel as well. So if you don't watch it here, you can feel free to watch it on Tangelica the Black Sheep. So this is why I'm just going live, and then I'm just going to put it on my YouTube so that we can get this message across to younger people that can identify with some of this stuff I'm talking about. Because I know a lot of people that's on my friends list, their parents were so perfect, Vivian, that, you know, my lives is like very, very insulting to them. And that's fine. You know, kick your ass off. That's all I can tell you. Get that ass up out of here, because a lot of people that's my age, I am 44, they know, the people that's my age know damn well, our mamas was off the freaking chain in the 80s. We ain't gonna sit up here and tell no damn lie. Not tonight, we not. We gonna get honest. Ladies and gentlemen, turn to your neighbor and say, tonight we gonna get honest. And if you know anything about the late Miss Betty Wright, tonight is the night. Let me tell you something. Let me explain something to you, ladies and gentlemen. I really and truly can recall back in the 80s, because I lived in South Central. I lived off of 110th in Compton. I also lived off of in Imperial Courts. I lived off of 111th. Shout out to the Bell Havens. Shout out to all of Watts and Compton, the East Side, period. I lived all over. And it was cracking in the 80s. Ladies and gentlemen, that song Rock Steady was a big hit. It looked like some of the people took that damn song to a whole nother level. I don't too much like that damn song now, because I remember hearing it. They all locked in the damn room. They come out sweating, looking crazy. I'm watching children like I gave birth. And it's just so sad. It's so sad. Hi, Andre Miles. Thank you for tuning into my life. Tonight, I'm talking about in celebration of my upcoming sobriety date. And I'm still from the hood. Still from Avalon Crip. Shout out to all my homies, cuz I'm still sharing my story in detail about the making of an alcoholic. I have a YouTube channel as well, and it's called Tangelica the Black Sheep, and I have dialogue on there. Also, if you go down my timeline, you'll see that I'm connected with CBS, NBC, and ABC. So, I'm pretty much on the map. I'm not a mediocre person. I'm on the map. Check me out in holler, cuz. Otherwise, keep scrolling. A lot of people is just on here being nosy, too. You know, a lot of people I see that be on my platform, they only tapping in just to see, is she sober? Yep, bitch, I am still sober. And it's all good. I'm not even mad at that either. I don't care. It's flattering to me. I'm a Gemini. Any attention is better than none at all. But back on these narcissistic, negligent parents from back in the 80s, they was partying hard as hell. And I just remember having a lot of parental responsibilities. And it was extreme. It wasn't like keep an eye on your little sister or brother for a couple hours while mom and, you know, mom and Mr. Ronnie. Married Ronnie. And I can't forget that because a lady named Geraldine called and wanted to whoop my mom's ass about her husband. So I never forgot that either. Geraldine. And my mom did a whole lot of arguing, and they never fought though. But I never understood why this guy, you know, the only time we could see a nice side of my mom in the 80s was when this weirdo would come around. He always has some old cheap cologne on, hair in a jerry curl, and that song Rock Steady always come on, and they be sweating and looking crazy while I'm in there babysitting the children, and they done put us on some damn hot dogs. Now, mind you, a lot of this stuff, it sounds funny, and I do a lot of laughing, but I'm the type of person that laugh sometimes to keep from crying, and sometimes I laugh out of embarrassment. So, me laughing about being fed hot dogs, you know, really, and sometimes this was just once a day, ain't shit really funny about this, you know. And mind you, these parents really were telling themselves even back then that the Lord touched them and they should be ordained to be some type of evangelist and all this weird stuff. But anyway, so I remember that song Rocksteady used to always come on, and they would be in there getting high and loaded and drunk. And I would be, of course, since I'm the oldest daughter, responsible for the kids. And anything go wrong, anybody start crying, you're looking at the person who took all the ass whoopings, you know, because she ain't too much care for me since I look so much like my father. Finally, when they would pass out, I would just walk around the house and just pick up the cans and the cigarettes, and I would drink whatever I found. That's what I would do. This video is about the making of an alcoholic. So, and a lot of people is not gonna like this video, especially overly religious people. And I don't care. I don't care. I put this in the Lord's hands back in the 80s and nothing ever was done about it. So now I'm gonna tell my damn story. Hate it or love it, I'm gonna tell my, I'm gonna speak my truth. So yeah, I would be walking around the house looking for beer cans and cigarette butts. I had already started exploring all that. Plus, I told you, my mom, she used to give me, you know, she used to give it to me to go to sleep. And she was giving it to me as a baby, too. She didn't care too much about my future. She just didn't. She probably didn't think I had one because I looked so much like my daddy. She already written me off as gonna be a nothing-ass bitch anyway. So, Rocksteady, that song would constantly come on. And I also remember that song by the God help me remember some of these names too, because I have a lot of brain fog from all the drinking that I did over the years. What's Love Got to Do with It would always come on by Tina Turner. Rock Steady. Just Got Paid. That song would come on a lot. And I remember, Hey, How Are You? I don't know if I'm pronouncing it right, but hello, how are you doing? You do a lot of flirting, and I'm not trying to talk to nobody on my Facebook, but we could definitely be friends. Thank you for tuning into my live. But yeah, so this is about the making of an alcoholic. So I'm talking about how did I get to that point to where now I'm about to celebrate a year sobriety, not through AANA or CA either, ladies and gentlemen. That didn't work for me either. I know that's going to make people unfriend me and some bullshit, because we have this mindset that anything got to do
with me. She's a mom, takes care of business with a smile. The warm attitude's cool when you're rude. Sweet when she creeped ya, you're wrong, she'll dismiss ya. With such style and such grace, she brings class to the place. When she walks through the room, you have to assume that she's a
Davis.
Keeps it real like that.
I keeps it real.
We are in a state of emergency.
Prejudice. Because it is a platform, but if we are able to be responsible on this platform,
to uplift, elevate, okay, encourage, and inspire. Diamonds, okay. All women, but especially black women.
Christianity cannot be fallible. And it shows how brainwashed and simple-minded we have become. We have literally begin to delegate our thinking process to other people. Hello, Kevin LeMay. Tonight I'm discussing the making of an alcoholic. And this is my story, and I'm gonna be talking about not only the making of an alcoholic, but why I'm not Christian. So this is what I'm gonna be talking about. So ladies and gentlemen, live and let live, and follow your Bible, which says, "Do not judge." Which I don't care if you judge me, just judge me by getting the fuck out of here, because this is my story. So anyway, I remember picking up the drinks and cleaning up behind my mom and her company, and looking in the ashtray for my mom. At that time, smoked Benson and Hedges. So I would and this is when parents smoked in the house. So you know, we never had a chance of a clean environment, ladies and gentlemen, because we always smell smoke. Always. You know, and it was okay to smoke in your house in the 80s. And so nobody judged you for smoking, which that's something you Christian people should have been judging, was the fact that you guys were smoking over children. Smoking over children. Going to church on Sunday and smoking over children. Somebody turn to your neighbor and tell your neighbor, "Neighbor, smoking over your children create secondhand smoke and cancer." So, and the reason why I'm going sarcastic as well too, because my mom, she says I curse too much, and this is why she can't be my friend on Facebook. Somebody that smoked plenty of dope in my face, drunk alcohol, left me with her children for days at a time with no electricity or gas. I was using a barbecue pit, ladies and gentlemen, to cook rice on it for my siblings. And we only had candles in the house. We lived off 111 Drive in Belle Haven, with no electricity and no damn gas in the house, until finally she moved us somewhere else, which I went to all the schools in Watts because my mom never could keep a place. The making of an alcoholic, ladies and gentlemen. So I lacked a parent with sense enough not to smoke in the house with me, drinking all around me, partying with a married man, which his name was, I think his name was Ronnie or Ron. Ron, she called him Ron. He had a wife named Geraldine that used to call my mom and say she gonna beat her ass, and I don't know what happened to that, but all I know is that she would do anything we asked her when this married man would come over. "Mama, can I go outside?" "Yeah, y'all go outside and play. They get so nice. Go get a Twinkie. Y'all get y'all a couple of those." My mom used to make us, she used to make us freezes, because she didn't want to spend on her wine money on us something to drink. So she would freeze the Kool-Aid and make us icy cups, which they were good, but you know, that wine money, boy, that wine money and that Benson and Hedges money, you know, couldn't be touched. So yeah. And I just remember always wanting to sneak her beer, you know, because when we were in front of people, I was, you know, wait till she duck off somewhere and I'll drink her shit. Or when she by herself, when that nigga gone, I could drink openly with my mom. Yeah, that's the making of an alcoholic right there. Then the fact that when my father passed away in 89, I already had it made up in my mind that I didn't want to live. And I was 11 then. So as soon as when I got to middle school, high school, I started sending smokers in the store to buy my drinks. And I didn't even want to live without my father. So I started drinking real, real heavy. My mom never cared at all. Now that I have teenagers, I could have never, ever, ever approved of my daughter or son drinking and smoking at 14. Not in this mind. You know, I just couldn't have. But my mom did. She didn't care about me drinking, but my sister, the one she say gonna be the doctor, she never okayed her to drink with her or nothing like that. She always had her on a higher pedestal or whatever. That's how narcissistic parents are. They play favorites. So me and my sister had a very tumultuous relationship because of her playing favorites and treating. And some people say that doesn't affect, but if you go sit in some NAAA and CA meetings, one of the number one reasons why they say that they made it to those places was because they said they never fit in. Well, I don't remember fitting in either. I don't remember fitting in. So I was the oldest. I was left-handed. I was dark like my father. In the 80s, it wasn't okay to be this damn complexion. In the 80s, our parents was high as fuck. Especially the ones who were about 25 to 27, they was high, freebasing. They was high as hell. High as hell. And, you know, and it is just so crazy because she was so full of Jesus on Sunday, but it still didn't stop her from smoking and drinking and partying the rest of the week as if Jesus ain't did nothing for her. So my concept of religion was warped really from a child. So all you perfect church-going parents, understand this. Some of us judge y'all as hard as y'all judge other people. And I'm one of them. If I see that your actions don't match your behavior of what you perpetrating, I'm going to call you on your shit, embarrass you, and I'm not going to value anything you have to say. Because you're supposed to show some form of Christ, like if you Christian, right? I don't see some people emulating that. I don't see my mother. I don't see nothing Christ about this child abuser. I've tried looking at it sober, drunk, high, and I can't find it. Thank you very much. You are special. You are special too. You are special to me too. You're my daughter as well. So, I wish my mother could have told me this, because everybody on this life can tell me this. But the making of an alcoholic came into play and manifested because your mother and your father is your first love. And if these two people are not capable of giving and showing you love, you're not going to believe it from anybody else, ladies and gentlemen. I never believed a boy when he told me I was beautiful. Never. Never believed him. Never believed anybody after that. To be honest, to be real, real honest, even the people that are in my family that I know had my best interests at heart, couldn't believe it. Because it's hard to believe that your mother or father loves you, or anybody else loves you, if your mother and father has demonstrated hate. I understand my mom praised my little brother. It was hurtful. She told me he would be the one to take care of her, and she killed her. Let me see. And she killed herself if I had to. Wow. But my brother passed, and I was the one who took care of her. That is just so sad right there. Not only that, but it's cold as fuck to say that to your daughter. It's cold as fuck to say that to your daughter. And then we wonder why we will stay in an unhealthy relationship and marriage. I'll tell you why, ladies and gentlemen. Because if my mother can break my heart, everybody else is welcome to do it too. We comfortable with it. I never, ever thought it was wrong to be beat on until my teacher, her name was Miss Naughty. I was in the fourth grade. I took my sweater off or something, and she walked up to me with these big old tears in her eyes, and she said, "Can you come here?" And she was like lifting up, examining me. This is at 112th Street Elementary School. She said, "This is the first time Pastor Jenkins lost us Christians. So keep that in mind. My mom is legally an ordained pastor. So this is why it makes it even that much worse. Because I thought pastors are supposed to love children, especially their own. Anyway, this teacher, Miss Naughty, I will never ever forget this teacher. I'm actually looking for this teacher right now, who taught at 112th Street Elementary School, to go back and tell her thank you. Hi, G Swangin. A's up. I want to go back and tell this woman thank you, because this teacher, she raised up my shirt, G Swangin', and it was thick marks and bruises all over my arms and back and everything. I'll never forget that day at school. And Miss Naughty, she had a sick instinct that something was terribly wrong at home. And for some reason, I don't know why, but this is hard to talk about, but this teacher would give me her lunch because for some reason she knew Pastor Jenkins didn't feed me. This is about the making of an alcoholic. And all you Christian people, if you can tag Ladrina Jenkins, I'm sure God will be happy. Because this woman needs to be held accountable for the making of the alcoholic. And not only that, but the pain that this woman has caused me. Because I didn't develop a drinking problem because I was a party girl, ladies and gentlemen. This had nothing to do with partying. This has everything to do with a bitch that was negligent. And I didn't raise myself. And on top of that, I come from a good, wholesome Christian family. And you want to hear what's funny? My Facebook friends and family is mad because I lost my faith in Jesus and Christianity after remembering Pastor Jenkins putting her foot on my neck and trying to suffocate me as a child, stomping me out like I was a bitch from swine. I mean, she would go in on me, and I wasn't no bigger than this, ladies and gentlemen. My daughter Jackie right here. That's my model. I was 5 in this picture. She was jumping on me like I was Geraldine, the married man wife. But what it really was, Shanika, is that she hated looking at him, my baby daddy. If y'all don't want these children, y'all need to stop having them. Because it really wasn't my fault. And these videos and lives that I'm doing is to heal emotionally, finally, because I could never seem to get it in church. Because I don't.
Told you a little while ago, these leaders that they call leaders, this included Lena Horne, this included Dick Gregory, and this included comedians, comics, trumpet players, baseball players. Show me in the white community where a comedian is a white leader. Show me in the white community where a singer is a white leader, or a dancer or a trumpet player is a white leader. These aren't leaders, these are puppets and clowns.
On my journey, family and friends, I am Tanji, the black sheep, Tangelika for short. Tanji is my name for short. Anyway, the way I quit smoking cigarettes cold turkey was I simply began to drink more water. More than anything else is I drink more water. I smoked cigarettes for 29 years. And that is the most profoundest thing I done was drink water, eat sunflower seeds, watch comedy, and not buy them. That's how I quit smoking cigarettes. Don't buy them. That works more than anything else. It's just don't buy them. I'm out. Trust them. I don't trust all of them. I'm just say that. I do not trust all of them. I definitely don't trust pastors. I don't trust pastors, period. So that's out. It's fuck. And yeah. So I'm gonna move right along, cause it's nothing else to really explain. I don't fucking trust them. I would never be Christian. I'm not the only person that feel like that who went through a lot of abuse. There's a lot of people in my close group on Facebook for narcissistic mother. I did a post and asked those women, it's only for women too, how many of y'all is still Christian or religious? I would say 60% of those women are free thinkers now. They are not bound to any type of religion. What if I told you Christian ladies that she beat the belief out of me? And she did. Because nothing could save me from this bully. This bully, this is the worst experience of being bullied that I could ever talk about. And it came from the person who gave me life. And ladies and gentlemen, the making of an alcoholic created me to seek comfort in drinking because I couldn't go to sleep for years because I was always being tortured with the memories of this bitch with her motherfucking feet on my neck. Or these whaps that was all over my back, my legs. Everything was scarred on me. And all the coward aunties and uncles that stood around and didn't fuck that bitch up, I don't have no respect for them either. Especially her own siblings. But hell, her sister ain't no better than her. She just as abusive to her own kids. But that's a whole nother story. But yeah, and I was like, what did I do, God? I used to ask God, what did I do? What did I do to deserve this? Not only did she close fist me at an infant, which my father told me everything. Before he left this earth, my dad told me my mom close fist me, and I was a newborn baby with a black eye, ladies and gentlemen. So, come again with why the fuck I should be a Christian? And don't tell me that I need to have the faith that Joel and these other parables and all that other shit, because I ain't really trying to hear that shit. Until you can walk in my shoes, I'ma just need for you to live and let live. I love you and I understand you. I know your pain. Thank you. Thank you. I wish I understood me. You understand something I don't even understand. All these years of therapy, I still can't understand what did I do to deserve this bitch putting her fucking foot on my neck, cuz. And then she wonder why I'm violent and crazy. And when you come close to me, I'm ready to bust you in your motherfucking head. Male or female. I keep two bats in my house. I stay ready, so I gotta get ready. And if I was able to have a concealed weapon, I probably would. It's probably in my best interest that I don't, because if I ever flash on her, she'd be my first victim. So she better be glad that I'm doing self-reflecting the right way. On my platform, minding my business, not hurting a soul. My truth do hurt though, because the overly religious people are incapable of allowing you to think for yourself, ladies and gentlemen. They have to control you. This is why I could never be a part of that. Most people that have been abusive to me believe in Jesus. That's one reason why I don't. So until the abusers stop believing in Jesus, I could never go back to Christianity. And furthermore, this ex-husband, which love the Lord, so he say, had a child outside the marriage, ladies and gentlemen. These is just clowns to me, man. Somebody turn to your neighbor and say, fake ass Christians. You need to follow your own Bible. And it's just crazy. It's crazy because these people tell me I'm going to hell because I lost hope and faith. I had no protector. DCFS took me from my mom 3 times and gave me back to that bitch. I don't know why. Kind of like the boy who died in the home of his biological mom. And the people who deserve their kids back, they don't give them back. Look at when I'm gonna get India. She about to be grown. My house is loving. Ain't nothing wrong up in this house. And I'm not big on corporal punishment because of my own childhood. Or I have ways to get at my children without beating the crap out of them and making them feel unloved and unworthy and all that. But the making of an alcoholic. So those are a lot of the reasons, along with the fact that every time I thought about her, I wanted to drink. I didn't want to face my reality. I didn't want to feel my reality. And even though people in my life tried to love on me, the truth of the matter is I wanted Pastor Jenkins' love. The person who gave me life. And even though, you know, my dad's side was my strong support system, the fact that I really wanted my mom never left my mind. Even though I went on and embraced my grandmother's love, guess who still felt incomplete? Nina. Hi, Nina. How's my goddaughter? Look, I'm already telling you what the sex of the baby is, huh? That's my goddaughter up in there. I already know it. So, look what I'm making. I'm putting this in this, it's good too. Yeah. It's that air fryer. Yeah. Yeah, y'all need to get with it. This is way more healthier than the my pretty fried chicken. Well, I'm trying not to eat the wrong way. And I know Josiah. He probably, come on, Josiah. Thank you. I'm sure it is good. I'm not gonna have any right now because I choose not to eat after 6. And I'm discussing in this part 2 the making of an alcoholic. Go ahead and grab you some spinach salad and you don't want the spinach salad, you can have you just a nice fat sandwich. And yeah, grab the salad. I'm live right now. Yeah, and we got some Sprites in the freezer. I got some Sprites. So there we go. Yeah, thank God it's the 8th. Tomorrow we gonna go to that grocery store and do our thing. Yeah. So, I was just explaining to my friends and family that's tuning in on this live how Pastor Jenkins kept sending me to school, and I had waps all over my arm. Some of my waps and wounds is still on me to this day, Christians. And y'all wonder why the hell I don't have no respect. I don't have a reason to, ladies and gentlemen. I don't have no reason to. My mom always was doing something cruel and fucked up to me as a kid. You know, this is the making of an alcoholic. And these are some of the issues and the things. You spell my name right. I salute you for that. God, you just don't know how much that means to me. Because my mom spelling in that triggering way. I hate the way she spelled my name. But, I remember when we lived on 111th and Compton Avenue. I went to Floyd Noy Elementary School. And my mom, you know, she was always doing something fucked up, man. It was Christmas in 87. And my brothers and sister, I had a younger brother and a younger sister. I'm the oldest. Hey, Leah. Look, Leah up. She ready to get it. Get your sugar, mommy. Get your sugar, mama. Christmas in 87, she was like, you was bad at school. You didn't get nothing for Christmas. You was bad at school. I'm every bit of 7. Every bit of 7. You know, back then, I think the most desired toy was Barbies in the Rockers. I wanted a Barbies in the Rockers. I saw that she got my brother and sister a bike. And there was absolutely nothing under the tree for Tangie. Nothing. Not nothing. I was so heartbroken. I couldn't even talk. What I did do is I ran to the corner with a dime. And I called my father. I got a real father. I don't have these old fake ass tax time dads. I made one call of my father. And you better please believe it, before the sun went down, my father had a pink bike. And he might have had his damn drink in his hand, but he got that bike to his daughter. That's what he did do. But I just still remember the emotional pain that I felt as a 7-year-old child feeling so left out, so excluded. So I don't even think, to be honest, I don't even think 40 more years of therapy would take that pain away that I felt. Because I've done it. I have went to therapy. I have, if you part of NAAACA, I have did a 4th step. I have did everything but heal the inner child. I've definitely tried waiting on Jesus to take the pain away. And that, I don't even know if that kind of pain can be taken away. You said, God is good, me too. And still got my daddy too. Forever daddy's girl. And look just like him too. I do understand, and that is a blessing. That is a straight blessing, man. So yeah, with that being said, the making of an alcoholic, those deep wounds contributed to me.
Walking in my Balenciennes, trying to bring out the fabulous. Cause I give a fuck way too much. I'ma need like two shots in my cup. Wanna get up, wanna get down.
Temple on Earth, this is Tangelica the Black Sheep. I'm just giving you a shout out on this lovely bright Saturday. Greetings from Canoga Park, California. And I just wanted to say that I'm gonna spend my Saturday, after I'm done deep conditioning my hair, I'm gonna be tuning into the Reality Temple on Earth, and you should too. Peace and blessings, love, peace, and soul. Control decision to continue to drink from 14 to, you know, because I've stopped. I've had intervals where I've stopped, but this is the first time where I said, you know what? I want to improve my life and my health. And this is not about a DCFS or anything like that. I don't have no open DCFS, nothing. I just want to be good to Tangi. And I need to figure out why did I even drink so much? It's not a crime to drink. What is a crime to drink until you pass out? Because you don't want to feel anything. And I felt like that, Nina, at 7. I was drinking already. I was already drinking. I was drinking with my mom. I was drinking at 14. I was drinking on a regular from 14 on up. And I developed a very strong drinking problem. And I don't think it's because I just like the taste. I really and truly believe that it's much deeper than that. Even though a lot of weirdos in AA, NA, and CA, hey T, would try to tell me, you drink for cause and effect and all of this other shit. Nah. No, I'm not buying that. No. What if I told y'all it's even more simple than that? What if it's just the fucking fact that I'm hurt and I don't want to feel the pain? I don't want to feel the neglect and the rejection that Pastor Jenkins put on me. And if this was your mother, I'm very curious, because all you Christian women, I hope y'all stay with me on this, because I got some questions for y'all. If Pastor Jenkins was your mama, honestly, and I do mean honestly, and you lost your children, you lost everything about your life that meant something to you over the nonsense. Not that it's going to affect my feelings, but I'm just curious to you infallible people, how would you feel about her? Would you still let her be in your life? If she done the things that Pastor Jenkins has done, would you still want a relationship with somebody who left you in the house for 3 days with their children and went to go smoked up with a married man for days? She was going on her bench for days. Left me in a house with candles. I'm cooking they rice on a barbecue. I didn't even know how to cook rice. That's why, that's how I know I'm still triggered. I have this rice right here still unopened. Still unopened. Won't even open this shit. Because I don't even like cooking rice. Because when I think about when I had no choice but to cook the rice, it makes me want to pick anything for a side dish beside that. I know Leah's gonna like this. She likes raviolis. So I don't know. I just feel like this woman, if it was left up to me, I think she should go to jail. I don't really care that she's terminally ill or any of that stuff. I really don't. I don't wish it on her, but I still don't care. I feel like she should go to jail, because you said no, I wouldn't. Wow. For once, somebody under fucking stand. For once. And when I say once, I got family members that tell me, but of course they real overly religious they self. They've been indoctrinated all their life. You should forgive her and move on and overlook that. Overlook the vision that she knocked out of my eye when I was a 2-month-old baby.
overlook the fact that this woman still to this day don't know my worth, can't see my worth. She always tell me about how she met somebody that's about my age that she's so close with. That's another thing about Pastor Jenkins. Miss Duffy Johnson, my mom would love the fuck out of your daughters, would treat them like her own daughters, but she can't even do that with her own. My mom have always been good to other people's daughters. My mom would spoil the fuck out of your children, Miss Nina. My mom would love to play and nurture your newborn baby. But this is something she could never do for her own children. My mom have decent relationships with other people's children, just not her own. And I just think that is so strange. How can you look your daughter in the face and know you're responsible for blinding me in my left eye that I just recently talked to my primary doctor today? We're going to try to get the corrective surgery. What if I want to drive a car too, Pastor Jenkins, one day? I've never got a chance to. Because you took something from me before I could even enjoy my own eyes. My mom had apartments in my name and all type of shit before I was even fucking with pubic hair on my damn private. And what kills this situation more than anything, and it enrages me, because any one of y'all is welcome to come to the doctor with me anytime. Or we can go to the court building and I can go pick up Pastor Jenkins' paperwork, because Ladrina Renee Hamilton is my mother. I can go and get them motherfucking papers from DCFS. Wouldn't even let my mom visit with my children. Do you hear me, ladies and gentlemen? Turn to your neighbor and say, no, Pastor Jenkins, you can't visit. And my mom's case was, I promise to God, over 30 years old. They was like, hell no. So for DCFS, they wouldn't even consider her for placement. And my mom had, at that time, about, I want to say 4 years clean or something like that. I know people are like that to this day, Tangie. That's so sad. Yes, ma'am. And I never was able to tell, my mom how hurtful, you know, what she's done to me. I've tried doing AACA. They told me, well, you play a part in your abuse with your mom. How the fuck do you make sense out of that? This video is about the making of an alcoholic. So guess what that made me do? I think after I did a 12-step with my sponsor, guess what I went and did, y'all? When she proved to me that I was responsible for getting molested at 5 years old. And when I told Pastor Jenkins, she put some more scars and bruises on me. Some of them I still bear to this very fucking day. But then y'all mad at me because I was praying for God to save me from this bully. And it just, at the time, it seemed like an eternity. Yeah. And I was just like, and I understand that there's a God, but I couldn't understand, why isn't he helping me? Why isn't he getting this bitch off me? And I still have these questions for God. But since I'm not getting an answer, I choose to just say, you know what? Pastor Jenkins, you're forgiven, but fuck you, bitch. And I'm never being Christian. Ever. So at this point, I'm just a free thinking woman that believes in God. That's it. That's it. I just know that God exists. I just didn't think he could work in my life. I've seen him work in other people's life, just not mine. Because I was praying to God when my sheets was wet and my mother would find them sheets. Oh, baby. I can't even make up these ass whippings with the stenching cord, with the, oh, man. And she had the nerve to send me to school. Miss Naughty, she was just in tears. I will never forget the tears my teacher had when she lifted up my shirt and was like, I have to, and she looked me right in the face and said, I have to call. I was so scared. All I could say is, please don't call because you're going to get me in trouble. You're going to get me in trouble. You're going to get me in trouble, Miss Naughty. She was like, I can't overlook. She said, your whole back is covered in wax. She was like, I cannot not say nothing. And guess what? Guess what DCFS did? I'm laughing, but I'm really devastated about this. They gave me back to her after a few classes and a few clean drug tests, me and my siblings. They gave us back to her three times. The making of an alcoholic, ladies and gentlemen. And all you know-it-all people that know how I should handle my pain, feel the fuck free to jump in my inbox, jump on this live. I would add your ass to the video and tell me how should I respond. What would your belief be if your mother really did all that shit to you plus more? I ain't even told y'all everything about my childhood. I don't have enough time to tell y'all everything about my childhood. Are you telling me that you would still just have this unshakable faith in Jesus and you would just overlook it and wait for Jesus to pour his vengeance out on Pastor Jenkins? You can get the fuck out of here with them fucking lies. Because I don't want to hear that shit. And even if you could, I salute you. That's not me. And so, with that being said, when them thoughts ran across my mind from 14 all the way up until when I got sober, I would drink. Had nothing to do with partying. Sometimes I was drinking and doing a lot of crying. Sometimes I was drinking and doing a lot of thinking. Sometimes I was drinking and I was asking my creator, why wasn't I enough? I never felt enough for nobody. Really, neither one of my parents. And I know that's going to make my daddy's side mad too. But I know my dad loved me. But he still picked out.
Nobody takes down Angel Snuff Nuff 7 easy. There's a reason why, after 100 channels destroyed, Angel Snuff Nuff 7 is still here. There's a reason why nobody wanna get in a beef with Angel Snuff Nuff 7. But you don't take me seriously. And now your ass is barbecue.
On Earth is just something that I can watch all day long because I love knowledge. That's how Gemini people are. So that's what I'll be doing the remainder of this weekend, is tuning into the Reality Temple. Shout out to Brother Talik Ibn Rod and the Reality Temple on Earth. I give all my love, peace, and blessings to each and every person that literally watches show. There's no way you can watch it without learning. And I'm just still learning. I'm still absorbing. And I'm just glad to be a part of something so phenomenal. Peace out. Reality Temple on Earth. You know what's up. You're the best. Here on YouTube. Alcohol over me. So, my question have always been to my creator. What is my purpose? Because I'm not good enough for these people that fuck for me. So why am I here? Somebody turn to your neighbors and say, why is Tangelika Cox here? And sometimes I still ask myself that question. Why am I here? Because I still sometimes want to know, what was the whole fucking point, cuz? What was the whole point? I wasn't good enough for her. I wasn't good enough for him. Who the fuck was I good enough for? And I'm just gonna keep it real. Both sides of the family play favorites. A lot of exclusion. This is all the making of an alcoholic. Feeling excluded. Never feeling quite good enough, ladies and gentlemen. I'm not even going to lie to you. Some of my Facebook family and friends have validated me more than my own flesh and blood. Miss Vivian Duffy Johnson has validated me more than my own flesh and blood when it comes to that punk ass bitch. Miss Nina got them real mad. She has validated a lot of my motherfucking feelings. And she ain't never met me in person. I got some people that's telling me I should just forgive and move on. Move on. Don't worry about your eyesight. Don't worry about your eyesight. Don't give a fuck about your eyesight. Don't give a fuck about the permanent scars Pastor Jenkins put on you.
Forgive her and let the Lord handle her. And these same people that say all this bullshit, if it was them, would they have that same energy? I don't think Pastor Jenkins realized she's lucky to be alive. She really is. Because legally, with all the shit she's done, she's lucky. She's very lucky her children want to just move on with their life. Most of my siblings, they're just moving on with their life. They're not even worried about this bitch no more, man. They like, it's whatever. They doing their own thing. She lucky, all I want to do is just tell my fucking story. She lucky, that's all I want to do is tell my story. Honor thy mother and father. I wish a bitch ever would tell me that I have to honor her. I do show respect to my mother, but honor her? That's going a little too fucking far right there. Regardless of the fact that she gave me life, I didn't ask her to. And we gotta understand what be the ulterior motive to these child abusers having they damn children. Look at your neighbors and say, neighbor, babies don't keep a man. Because we have these babies. And then when Nathan start cheating, then we take it out on Naisha. You know, they even have to make the name like the father. You know, so, you know, Natalia, she's going to catch all the fucking heat from her daddy cheating. Yeah, you said that they don't. And you said, hell no. Nina said, hell no. You know, and, you know, this is all the making of an alcoholic. However, I'm going to start speaking about what have this year of being on this journey has done for me mentally and emotionally. I've cried a lot. I've cried a swimming pool because I just can't understand why I was not enough. So I won't let other people make me feel like that. I will not. If you exclude me, you count me out. Things of that nature is very triggering for me. Very triggering for me. So, that's so, so true. Babies sure don't keep no man. No, they don't keep no man. And I believe my mom only had us because she was really attracted to my father. And my father, I remember my father telling me, I can't stay with her because I don't like how she treats y'all. Now, this is what I want to say to the fathers who leave their children with a bully like Pastor Jenkins. It's your duty to protect your children. If you don't feel that she is a good fit for you in a relationship, you should go get your children. I feel like if my dad would have gotten his children, he would have had no choice but to get fucking sober, man. Because my mom had no business with children. My mom do not have the mental and emotional connection to be raising children. My mom does not even like Leah. And I'm laughing because she really don't. My mom has colon cancer right now. And she told me she can't be bothered with no baby at all. They make too much noise and all that. Like, girl, you can be bothered with some fucking penis though, huh? So, yeah. And she's never changed. She's never grew a tolerance for children, especially not her own. Other people's, yes, but not her own. She cannot be around her own children, but she can be around yours. And I still, with all the hurtfulness that my mom has done, if she picked up the phone and said, I need you to come out here right now. I'm not doing good. I'm sick. I'm still going to be on the scene. I'm still going to be on the scene. Because at the end of the day, I really am true to the fact that you only get one mother, one father, ladies and gentlemen. And even though she's a child abusing, fake ass Christian, she kept the pregnancy. She kept the pregnancy so I could tell this story to you guys, ladies and gentlemen. So if for no other reason, I still, in my own way, have a respect for her. But will I ever be Christian? Never. Never. I would never. Just the images of her putting her feet on my neck and whooping me with the stenching cords. And I remember praying to God during those whoopings. And nothing happened, man. I can't do it. I can't. I just can't. So, I'll take whatever punishment from the ultimate authority. If I gotta burn in hell because Pastor Jenkins beat the belief out of me, I'll take that. I'll take that. Because I still find it hard to believe. I do. So, yeah. As a result of all that, it made me become a very heavy drinker. It made me have very controlling natures about myself. Like, I could be very controlling too. I also could be very dismissive in relationships because in my mind, my head tells me I'm not worth it no way. So I'll leave you before you can even fall in love with me. So this is why I'm not in no relationship, because my head tells me that, let me see, Leah. Wait, girl, come here, let me see. My head tells me that either you're gonna hurt me or I'm gonna hurt you, so I might as well just cut my losses right now. And so that's what I do. I don't allow myself to get close to people. You say hi? You gonna say hi? You say hi? It might stink. The mommy tink.
Mommy sugar.
It's a sugar. It's a sugar. So, all I need is the love for my children, to be honest. And every now and then I call up a tall, handsome guy. But other than that, I'm okay. And that lets me know, too, that, you know, when you have a parent that don't instill that love in you, it makes it hard to receive love from people who really probably genuinely do love you. So I've always had a fear of success, a fear of failure, a fear of, I've just always had a lot of fear. A fear of being, even speaking on this camera, let me tell you, I had to go to college and do a Toastmaster class. I had to do things to get this comfortable in front of a camera. I never was comfortable with walking in my truth, never could give eye contact, never could give. People knew I was broken just because of how I was. Never could look you in the face. But that's why you blessed, because even with all she's done and put you through, you still would go and help her. Absolutely, because that's still my mom. And I can call her all the whores, bitches, and sluts I want, but if my mom told me some bitches was out there in Lancaster tripping, I would go out there and whoop all them hoes' ass for my mom. Period. Period. You know, because at the end of the day, you know, she's still my mom. She's still my mom at the end of the day. You know. I love you more, Miss Duffy Johnson. You don't make me cry. I love you more. Yes, and absolutely. My mom, if she needed me right now, of course. My mom did need me. My mom did need me. My mom needed me in February. My mom had a surgery. And on her stomach, she had the, what is that called? A stoma. So they had to untangle her large intestines and all that stuff. And that took about 15 hours. Me and my children was on Access. I took Access Transit out there to AV Hospital, and I let them motherfuckers know that I'm in this motherfucker, period. And I was right there. I bought her food. I bought her cosmetics. Because I told y'all I made peace with her. Just because I'm speaking on my childhood don't mean I don't love my mom. I still love my mom. If you watch my Tangelika story, I showed that I made peace with her when I was pregnant with Leah. But it does pisses me off that as she going through her fourth stage of cancer, because she like playing favorites and because she like invalidating me, my mom chooses not to be in touch with any of her adult children right now. And that is pissing me off. So, you know, at first I was like, okay, man, I'm going to just hold off on, you know, going there about my mom. And then I'm like, fuck that. What about my feelings? So when it comes to me, I have to think about my feelings. I'm suppressing drinking, smoking cigarettes, overeating, over having sex. I'm suppressing all these things. So I have to let out my anger some type of way, or then I can become a time bomb waiting to explode. And I be goddamn if I blow my shit.
Seven in the house, and we are standing here in front of O. Henry's, and we just had a great meal. I just want to tell my audience that we are number one supporting black business, and we had a good time here. Are you the proprietor? Oh, yeah. Did you want to come in and talk to the people? Angel Snowman said, here's the proprietor here. My best friend, Miss
Ada Taylor.
Yeah. We are standing here in front of Old Henry's restaurant, and we just had a real nice meal. Can you tell us a little bit about the restaurant and what you do here?
We sell soul food. As a matter of fact, we've been told that Old Henry's is one of the few soul food restaurants in the city of St. Louis, in the state, and in the Midwest. We plan to start our food truck next month.
Okay.
Want that food truck to go all over.
Alrighty then.
So, if we get the exposure, and we're already taking orders for events. We just took an order for July 31st. We took an order for July 29th. There's a guy who has a construction company. He owns quite a few of them. And we're going to be going to their sites and serving food, serving lunch. And we got a lot of interesting stuff going on.
All right.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome. I'm Angel Snow No 7. This is my friend,
Ada Taylor.
Ada Taylor. This is Old Henry Restaurant. If you're ever in the St. Louis area, come check them out. We had a good time just celebrating my sister's birthday. And everything was A-O-T.
All right. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Gomane, assemble the people, Gomane. We will not be defeated by witch doctors' illusions.
Yeah.
It's all about the Benjamins, baby.
Can't touch this. You can't touch this. You can't touch this. You can't touch this. You can't touch this.
Because I'm worrying about a bitch's feelings. So if Pastor Jenkins can't take my cussing, she need to get her ass over here and have a conversation with her daughter. That's what she need to do. Because I let her know that she's welcome to come to my house. I let her know she's welcome. I was going to be her power of attorney and everything. So, yeah. That's still at the end of the day. When the cancer start to take all the way over my mom, I'm going to be right the fuck out there to see everything. Please believe that. Because that's who I am. I have my father's heart. I don't have her heart. So I could never be her, even to her. I could never do that. So it's not in me. I'm cut from a whole different cloth. And if you Google my name, Tangelica, I'll give you $1,000 for all your friends who got my name. I'm the one and only, sugar. I'm the one. I'm going to say this one more time. Y'all turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, she the only one. I'm the one and only. When you Google Tangelica, my name, my previous address, my Facebook, my Instagram, my birthday, which is June 20th, only my shit gonna pop up. That's why can't nobody even use my identity. I'm the only one in the world with that name. It's Tangelina, Tangela, but it's not a Tangelica, spelt like my name, none of that. So with that being said, I'm one of a kind. And I think Pastor Jenkins knows that. She knows that. She know this daughter of hers is one of a fucking kind, cuz. And she know it. She know it. So don't get it twisted. But this is my sobriety month. I will be celebrating one solid year of cold turkey not drinking alcohol, not smoking cigarettes, and not smoking marijuana, ladies and gentlemen. And I feel good on the inside. I sleep better. I'm more productive. My blood pressure have improved. My mental health have improved because I battle depression a lot because of alcohol is a depressant for number one. And for number two, having Pastor Jenkins for a mom is very depressing. I swear to God, man, if I knew what I do now, I would have swam the other way. In my daddy nuts, I would have swam the other way. If I would have been able to foresee all this, because I used to cry and ask God, why am I woke? Why am I living? I mean, what is my purpose? Now I have a idea. I'm not going to say I know it all, because I don't. Geminis are very wishful, but I don't know my whole purpose. I have a good idea that I'm supposed to be telling my story and being a motivational speaker who also, because I have, when I went to college, I was studying law and political science. I need to go back and take the bar so I can pass that so that I can practice law. I'm really good with family law, business law. I need to do my, I have the templates too for credit repair. I have the templates for that. Geminis are really, they are jack of all trades. DCFS made me go study law and political science. I'm finna show you motherfuckers something. Okay, Miss Nina said, go ahead, cold turkey. Sheesh, I got cold turkey too soon. This nausea goes away. Yes, yes, and I'm gonna tell you something. What really helped me to do the cold turkey thing was I quit for about 4 months once before, Nina, and I noticed that I began to be addicted to the cigarette patches. And one time I didn't have no patches, guess what? I bought some cigarettes. So the patches is more than the cigarettes. So I said, okay. So I had a setback for about 30 days. I said, okay, this time I'm not doing no vapes, no cigarettes, no gums, no play cigarettes, none of that bullshit. This is just going to be old-fashioned determination, ladies and gentlemen. And I prayed as well. It's the weed for you? Oh, well, when I think about my weight and how weed make me want chili cheese fries with pastrami meat on top, hell, my blood pressure will never go down. Eat that. So weed make me want to eat too much, you know. But I'm like, nah. Nah, so yeah, I had to just quit cold turkey. And this is what you do. Because this is what, I think this solution really would apply to anything you're addicted to. And it's the most profoundest thing, and we all have it in our house right now. Ladies and gentlemen, you ready for this? Dun-dun-dun! Water. Let me tell you something. Drink a gallon of this every day. Every time you think about anything, drink this. Throw you a lemon in there. Throw you some berries in there because you're pregnant. That lower the blood pressure. Throw you some, make it real pretty. But drink so much of this till your pee is clear. And how I quit smoking cigarettes is I just fucking quit buying them. Quit buying them. So I ain't buying no, and that's just what I said too. See, what I had to learn, now I'm not going to tell nobody what to believe, but I'm going to tell you about my belief. Me being a free-thinking black woman, I have learned how to tap into my own power. We all have power within us. So, I gave my power to a pastor, but hell, he didn't have the power to fix his marriage. So I took my damn power back and applied it in my own life, ladies and gentlemen. Turn to your neighbor and say, you have some power too. You have some power too. So what I did was I made a decision. And I talked to God and I said, God, I don't want to smoke no more cigarettes anymore. Period. And I just need you to get me through this. And every time I wanted something to drink or smoke or weed, I drank me some water. And the reason why I picked water is because I didn't want anything to create more weight on me. So, to this day, before the night is over, I drink 3 waters. Throughout the day, I drink about maybe 3 to 4 waters, because my body, after smoking cigarettes 29 years, Nina, still tried to tell me to go get a pack of cigarettes. 60 days later into my journey, I lost my big homeboy and my uncle Mumbles, rest in peace, and a few other people from my hood. They all died of hypertension or cancer or something pertaining to these punk ass cancer sticks. That made my mind up. Keisha Cole, Mama Frankie, and I used to be like this. We was even in prison together. When Frankie died, I cried and I was like, oh no, cuz. And I got sober the day before her birthday. I was like hungover, trying to decide on whether I want to buy me some more to drink and all that. And when they announced on the news that Frankie died on her birthday, I was like, what the fuck, cuz? That was it. That did it. That did it. On July 19th, I will be having a dinner in her honor. That was my friend. If I ever get to meet Keisha Cole, I'll let her know, me and your mom was downtown selling dope and hustling, and your mom is, she's real solid. And I was in a pen with her mom too. And I know Frankie very well. Frankie's good people. You know, and I hate that she's not here because of her choices. And so I started looking at my own choices, and what if my choices make me leave my children early? Well, I already know Pastor Jenkins ain't gonna take my kids, ladies and gentlemen, because she don't even like her own kids. And like I told you, DCFS says she can't even visit. I'm trying to tell you, ladies and gentlemen, that case now, I'm 43, have to be at least, back then it was like 30. It has to be at least 38 years. They still won't let her visit with any of my kids. My kids is grown and they still say hell no. They asked me to, your mom and your kid's wife. I say, no, sir. No, sir. No, sir. That's the one thing I agree with the motherfuckers on. She don't need to be in my kid's life. They better off without her ass. Think they'd do a lot better without my mom. Y'all, this was a very, very touchy live and very deep. It's all true, you know. God bless my mom. You know, I really and truly hope that she can find peace with herself, because when I reflect on what she's done to me, I'd be breaking down for her because I know that cancer is a slow, miserable death, and she can't help but think about the shit she pulled on her children. That's why she don't want to see us either. She don't want to face us. She knows she wasn't no good mother to us. So, with that being said, to do this live, I would appreciate it if my friends and family would share this live for the young lady who may be in fear to speak up, or the young man that may be in fear. I'm not trying to reform no grown people that's set in their ways. If I can reach out to a young baby or a youngster who could take a look at what I went through in life and choose to make better choices, hey, my job has been done. Sharing my story is very liberating, but it's also my way of giving back, because I'm so appreciative for my sobriety, and I want people to know that you can do this too. It's not that I'm special or I'm real strong or I'm stronger than you. No, this is just simply, when you fucking tired, you'll be able to just stop. You don't need to be convinced. You don't need to be tricked. You won't need to be talked into it or none of that. You'll just simply stop, ladies and gentlemen. And you'll know when it's time, because you'll start to think about your mortality. I start thinking about my mortality when it comes to them cigarettes. I'm going to do a video tomorrow about my journey with cigarettes in more depth. And then I'll do one in depth about my alcohol, my battle with alcoholism. Like, what did that actually look like? I'm gonna do a whole live about, and it may not be a whole hour, but you gotta realize, for me, I drink on and off for at least 25 years. So a lot took place and transpired. And these are videos that is for the person who is battling alcoholism. And, you know, even if it doesn't apply to your life, in all families, I believe it's one person. They may not say it. You know, it's always one person, man. Always one person. And just to improve your health, I'm empowering my family and friends to take a look at their consumption, take a look at how much they're drinking, take a look at if y'all smoke cigarettes, how is this making my life healthy? I want you to ask yourself, if you smoke cigarettes, how is this making me healthy? How many years have this already took off my damn life? Damn. And the thing about cigarettes, man, is even after you don't smoke for 10 years, you can still die of lung cancer. So let's kind of think about putting them fucking cancer sticks down. I knew somebody who still developed lung cancer after quitting smoking. That kind of like made me like, damn, you know, well, at least I'm gonna try, you know. So, yeah, and I'm going to tell you this. My food tastes so much better. My food tastes good. I can breathe better. I'm not, like, short of breath all the time. My kids is not in the presence of secondhand smoke. Pastor Jenkins. My mom quit smoking cigarettes in 92. My mom has actually quit for about 30 years or something. She's done quit. But when I was a kid, my mom smoked. So she quit in, 92. So yeah, family and friends, that's it. Y'all heard my part two of The Making of an Alcoholic. You know, pass this information along to these young moms. You know, a lot of these young moms need somebody to talk to them and tell them, like, You know, I'm not trying to tell you what to do, baby girl, but don't tell your daughter, oh, she looks just like her daddy. She ain't gonna be shit. Don't tell her that. Don't play fucking favorites. Don't drink or use drugs with your kids. Don't indoctrinate them with your beliefs. Let your children go ahead and have their own thoughts. You'll be surprised if you give your children the option of thinking for themselves. Most of the time, they'll do what you want anyway. But the making of an alcoholic, you know, pass this information along. We need to be more supportive of our sons and daughters. We also need to allow fathers to be in their daughters' lives, if at all possible. Shout out to the men that are in their daughters' lives. Shout out to the mothers that is allowing their children to be in their father's lives. It's very important. Yeah, that nausea. Aww. I love babies too. That's so sad, man. Oh, I love babies. But I got an IUD now. I can't have no more. So I guess you're going to have to tag me pictures of yours, because I ain't going to have no more. But yeah, I'm about to go chill with my kids and find something to watch until I KO. And I appreciate everybody that took the time to watch this live, share this live. Tag Pastor Jenkins if you know her. Her name is Ladrina Jenkins. Tag her punk ass. I appreciate y'all. Till next time, I'm out. Love, peace, and soul.
The one thing I will never do is put a false charge on somebody. That's one thing I'll never do. I will never fucking put a false charge. The one thing I will never do is put a false charge on somebody. That's one thing I'll never do. I will never fucking put a false charge.
Questions for you, ladies and gentlemen. Did you subscribe to Tangelika the Black Sheep? Or were you a Rolling Stone? Incognito. Missing in action. Ladies and gentlemen.
Cornelius, and as always in parting, we wish you love, peace, and soul.